are so glad that you have joined us here tonight online for our Sunday evening worship service here at First Baptist Chatsworth. We're just thankful that we have the technology that we need nowadays to be able to go online for those of you that can't be here on Sunday nights and be able to worship with us. We're going to sing some songs tonight about worshiping the King and about how worthy our God is. And we encourage you just to sing at home with us as we're singing tonight, because, you know, whether we're all gathered together in this building or we're home watching online, we are all worshiping the same God. We're worshiping the same King, and we can praise Him together at the same time. So we want you to worship with us and sing with us tonight as we go. Let's sing together, Worthy of Worship. Him and praise Him tonight. He is the King above all kings and the Lord above all lords. Let's sing together tonight. How great is our God.
Age to age.
Shared the story before of a friend of mine who was in Cuba, in the communist state of Cuba, and he was directing a group of instrumentalists, and they asked him to come and play with the Cuban National Orchestra for a concert. And he had done an arrangement of this song, How Great Thou Art. And as he was standing in that hall with all of the communist dictator and the military officials and all the people that were there, as the orchestra began to play this song, he could hear the people in the room singing the words to How Great Thou Art. What a great song, and what a great God. Let's praise Him tonight as we sing How Great Thou Art.
Power throughout the universe display. Then sings my song, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my song, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. Gladly bearing, He bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration Thou art. Sing it now. Then sings my soul, my Savior. great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to be. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Amen and amen. Thank you. Pastor Mark.
Thank you so much, Brother Gary, and thank you for being a part of our study through the book of Revelation. We are in the trumpet judgments, and I want you to turn with me to the book of Revelation, chapter number 9. As we have gone through the trumpet judgments, I think it's so important for us to review each and every time that we open this up, because there may be people that are tuning in for the very first time. Beginning in Revelation chapter number 5, you find a scroll in the hand of God the Father, and in that scroll is the title deed of the earth. It is sealed with 7 seals. The picture of this is given there. It is also mentioned throughout the Old Testament. And there Jesus Christ goes to who Daniel describes as the Ancient of Days, and he takes from the right hand of God the Father this scroll representing the title deed of the earth. Each of the seals that are open, and there are 7 seals, represents a judgment of the wrath of the Lamb of God that Jesus Christ is going to pour out upon this earth as he takes back the earth from the usurper Satan. Oh, the glorious thought of all this is those of us who know Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, we're not going to be here because God has not appointed us under wrath. Not the wrath of the Lamb. Oh, sure, there are times where we go through tribulations and we go through chastisement. But we are never, because of the cross of Calvary and the blood of Jesus Christ, ever going to have to deal with the wrath of a holy and a mighty God. And in Revelation chapter number 6, the kings of the earth and the men of the earth, they describe this tribulation time on earth that will take place after the rapture of the church, after you and I look and see Jesus Christ coming in the clouds of heaven and he catches us up to be with him and all of our loved ones that have gone before us. There's going to begin on this earth a 7-year time of tribulation. Jesus said that the last 3.5 years of that tribulation period would be a time of tribulation that the world has never known. We're starting to understand why. The kings of the earth, as I mentioned in that in Revelation chapter number 6, they make this statement. They say, hide us from the one who sits upon the throne and the wrath of the Lamb. And that is exactly what this 7-year tribulation period that we study in Revelation chapter number 6 through 19 is. It is no longer the Lamb of God giving his life on the earth, but rather it is the Lamb of God that is pouring out his wrath. It is the Lion of the tribe of Judah being seen. In these 7 seals, as I've mentioned, you see the judgment of God being poured out upon the earth. You see different judgments that are given. We talked about them in depth. But when you come to the 7th seal that is opened, within that 7th seal contains both the 7 trumpet judgments and the 7 bowl judgments. In Revelation chapter number 8, we looked at the first 4 of these these trumpet judgments. The first one was a judgment upon the land. The second trumpet was a judgment upon the sea. The third was a judgment upon the fresh water. As a third of the sea, a third of the fresh water, a third of the ships in the sea, a third of the trees and the shrubs and all the green grass, it was totally destroyed. And then the fourth trumpet was a judgment of the sky or the universe as the lights that we so much depend upon, the sun and the moon and the stars, they are affected as the heavens are rolled up like a scroll. And then look at this fifth trumpet. Whenever you study through Revelation number 8, chapter number 8, he talks about the woes that are going to come. He said there have been 4 trumpets, but there are fixing to be a woe, a woe, a woe, and it is the last of the 3 trumpets. The first woe is this 5th trumpet, and it was what we looked at last week, hordes of demons that will torment men for 5 months on the earth. They will be released out of the abyss, and they will be allowed to come and to torment men without being able to kill them. And they'll do that for the space of 5 months. And we looked at that in depth last week. But this week, I want us to note Revelation 9:12. He says, "One woe is past, and behold, there come two woes more hereafter." We're going to look at that second woe. And that second woe is the sixth trumpet. Read with me in Revelation 9:13. "And the sixth angel sounded, and I heard a voice from the four horns of the golden altar, which is before the throne of God." Now, before I get into my outline and the details, I want you to note where this particular voice comes from. It comes from the golden altar. And this altar has been described for us in Revelation 6. From underneath this altar were the prayers of the martyrs, and they are asking for vengeance. Whenever you study through this and you really begin to look at it, it is amazing that there is vengeance that is going to be prayed for. There is a voice of vengeance that is literally going to be declared as you look in Revelation 8. And the Lord says, "I want you to take fire from off of this golden altar, put it in a censer and cast it to the earth." And there was all kinds of lamentations, and there was lightning, and there was thundering. And it was the precursor of the judgment of God that would come upon the earth. And so right here from this golden altar, a place that whenever you study the tabernacle here on earth, it was a place where people would come and they would call out to God and they would cry out to Him. It was a place of prayer and intercession. Listen to this, specifically for mercy. But whenever you come into Revelation 9 and 13, it is no longer a place where men and women and boys and girls are praying for mercy, but rather the multitudes that cannot be numbered that have been martyred are now praying for the vengeance of God. And why are they doing that? Because it is a time of vengeance. They are praying according to the will of God. "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." And as we'll see as we study through these tremendous and horrific judgments that are going to be coming from heaven itself, it is in accordance with the will of God as He ushers in His kingdom here on earth and ultimately the eternal kingdom which Jesus Christ will rule and reign over forever and ever and ever. John on the Isle of Patmos, there in prison, sentenced to this island, he hears a voice from the four horns of the golden altar. Most people believe it is the voice of the Lamb. As I was reading this, I thought, aren't you glad that God speaks? In this instance, He's going to be speaking and giving an angel clear direction on how to pour out a judgment on the earth that will end in taking back the earth and Him establishing His kingdom. But for you and me today, aren't you glad that God still speaks? Sometimes He speaks a word of comfort whenever we're going through trials and difficulties. He comes and He wants us to know that He loves us and He cares for us, that He's watching over us. Sometimes He speaks a word of conviction. He warns us because of what sin will do to our lives and the devastating effects of sin. And He wants the best for us. Sometimes He speaks a word of encouragement. Oh, we get depressed and downhearted and we don't know what we're going to do and what we should do and our spirits seem to be in despair. And He takes us to where the psalmist was and He says, "Why are you cast down, O my soul? Put your hope in God. In my distress, I cried unto the Lord and He heard me and He answered me out of His holy hill." Oh, how often He answers us in times of despair, wanting us to know that He loves us, that He's walking with us, that this is not the end. And He gives us the grace to be able to make it through whatever trial and whatever burden God might be bringing our way and allowing to come into our life. Aren't you so glad that there is still a voice that is being heard? Not one just in the future of judgment, but one now to the saints of God, of encouragement, even of enlightenment, as we open up the Bible and He illumines our mind to who He is and all that He's done for us. And He lifts our hearts to the street of gold and the gates that are made of pearl in that city four square. And we set our affections not on a world of woe and of heartache and of pain, but rather on a place of glorious bliss, where the saints of all the ages are going to spend an eternity at this very altar worshiping the one that many theologians believe is speaking, could it be that the Lamb that is before the throne is speaking here? I hope you hear Jesus this week speak to your heart a word of encouragement, a word of comfort, maybe a word of correction because he cares for you so very much. Maybe he's going to show you a special golden nugget out of his word. Oh, how exciting it is when he does that. And maybe you're watching and you've never been saved. And maybe you'll hear a voice from that altar that says, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest." But I'm so glad there is a voice that still speaks. It could be that you're watching tonight and there's a voice from the altar that says, "I want you to come and follow me and I'll make you a fisher of men." Maybe the Lord is wanting you to get involved in evangelism, or maybe God's calling you to preach. Maybe he's calling you to the mission field. Maybe he's calling you to be a Bible professor. But there is a voice that is heard, and it's heard from the four horns of the golden altar where the saints of God have been praying. And so often that's where we hear from God as we talk to him and we open his word and he answers us through the scripture. This is a picture of that golden altar before the throne of God and the veil. It was as it was depicted in Moses' day in the tabernacle. Revelation 9:14, he says this, saying to the sixth angel, this is most likely Jesus, the Lamb, and the voice that is heard from that golden altar, and he says to this sixth angel, you say, what is the sixth angel? You've just joined us. Well, at the beginning of Revelation 8, there were seven angels that were standing before the presence of God. We believe those are archangels. Gabriel said, whenever he came to earth, he said, "I am Gabriel and I stand before the presence of God, waiting to do his bidding." And here this archangel is standing, this sixth angel. Five have already taken their trumpets and blown their judgments, but he had the sixth trumpet. And this is what Christ says to him, "Loose the four angels which are bound in the great river Euphrates." Now I want you to note, he says, "And the four angels were loosed, which were prepared for an hour and a day and a month and a year for to slay the third part of men." This is the sixth trumpet. I want you to note, first of all, the release of more demons. They were released from a very precise place, saying to the sixth angel which had the trumpet, "Loose the four angels which are bound in the great river Euphrates." You say, "Brother Mark, how do you know that these are demon angels and not good angels?" Because they're bound. And common sense just tells us that there's no reason for God to bind an angel that is going to do his bidding. And that is what the scripture says of good angels, that they are ministering spirits that are sent forth to minister to you and to me, and they do the will of God. They stand in the presence of God, and some of them worship him. Some of them stand there, I believe, for great assignments like these seven. Others are just there, a multitude of angels that cannot be numbered, is how Hebrews 12 describes the good angels in heaven. But these are bound angels. They remind us of the angels that were loosed from the abyss that we studied the last time. And for some reason, these angels are bound in the great river Euphrates. There's a lot of information that we have about the river Euphrates. It is one of the rivers, the four rivers, that ran through the Garden of Eden. It is where the first sin was ever committed or birthed. It is where the first murder was ever committed, where the first rebellion against God's word ever took place. It was near that Euphrates River where Cain refused and rejected to offer a blood sacrifice, but rather it was his own man-made, thought-up religion. We believe seducing spirits and doctrines of demons, but it was from the heart and the mind of that man that came the very first false religion. The first rebellion against God's word took place near that river. Babylon was built upon the banks of the Euphrates River, as well as the Medo-Persian Empire. The great political systems of the earth were born there. Rome, Greece, Babylon, Medo-Persia, the four great world empires. And it divides the Middle East and the Far East. But notice in Daniel chapter number 10, verse 13 and 20, it teaches that the great Gentile world powers that are all around this Euphrates River, they had demons that were associated with them. And it could be that these are the four great demonic powers that we see in Daniel 10, 13, and 20. You study them, and in Daniel 10, 13, and 20, Michael the archangel has come to Daniel, and he said, I heard you when you first started praying, but I was detained for 21 days as I fought with the prince of Persia. In other words, there was a demonic force that was over the nation of Persia that he was fighting. And then in verse number 20, he says to Daniel, he said, I've got to go back and I've got to fight this prince of Greece. And the implication there is that there are nations that are being influenced by very great demonic powers. And most Bible theologians that I study after, and I personally believe that these four demons are these four great demonic powers. And these demonic powers are going to rise, and they are going to influence and literally bring devastation upon the earth. Notice they are released from a precise place, the River Euphrates. They are released for a precise time. Revelation 19:9 in verse number 15a says, and the four angels were loosed, which were prepared for an hour and a day and a month and a year. You say, Brother Mark, what does that tell you? It tells me that God has a very specific timetable. This is not something that is happenstance. This is not something that is just going to happen by falling out of the sky. This is a part of the plan of a holy and a righteous God. Whenever you study the book of Isaiah, it speaks about the government being upon the shoulders of one who would come from the lineage of David. We know that is none other than Jesus Christ, and we know that he'll rule and reign, and he will reign over the nation of Israel and literally over the whole world, because the entire Old Testament speaks of a coming king, a Messiah, who will do that. And he says this in the book of Isaiah, chapter number 9. He says, how is this going to happen? How is the government going to be upon his shoulders? He says, the zeal of the Lord of hosts shall perform this. All of the energy of an almighty God is put behind this prayer coming to pass. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. He is going to see that it comes to pass. In Mark chapter 24 and verse number 36, they've asked the Lord Jesus Christ about his kingdom. And he says, of that day and hour knows no man, no, not the angel of heaven, but my Father only. He knows, listen, the very hour, the very day, the very month, and the very year when these four angels will be loosed from heaven. He knows exactly when it's going to take place, and he will see that it comes to fruition. It is going to not just be the release of more demons. It is not going to be just at a specific time. But I want you to note next the return of death. And let me go over my outline with you. It is going to be for a precise time. It is going to be from a precise place. The release of more of these demons, as we've studied in chapter number 8. But you're also going to see the return of death. If you were to go back and study the fifth trumpet, death fled from man. Man was not able to find death for a space of 5 months. They would be tormented by these demonic hordes that were released from the abyss, and men would seek after death, but never would be able to find it. Well, here is the return of the King of Terrors, as Job called him, none other than death itself. And the four angels were loosed, which were prepared for an hour and a day and a month and a year for to slay the third part of men. Here is an unprecedented devastation that will come upon the earth. One third of the people of the earth are going to be killed. We looked up a little bit earlier today how many people are on the earth. Over 8 trillion people are on the earth. This would be 2.5 trillion people today. Now, we believe that the population will be less than that for a number of reasons. Number one, we believe the rapture of the church will take all of those who are alive before the 7-year tribulation begins that make up the church of Jesus Christ. That's going to be a large number of people, I hope, that will be raptured and taken up to be with the Lord. And then, whenever you study the trumpet judgments, we know that one fourth of all those that are on the earth are going to die by means of war and by plagues and by famine. This is before this particular judgment comes. So you have already seen a large portion of people that have died. If you add one fourth and a third together, that is over one half of the population on earth that has died. You've already had the rapture. Now, note this, you've also had a multitude that cannot be numbered who have trusted Jesus Christ as their Savior. I'll tell you this, I believe there will be a massive revival that will take place during the time of the tribulation. There will be people that will repent, and we know that because of Revelation 7. Whenever John sees them and the angel asks John, who are these? He said, I don't know, you know. He said, these are those who have come out of great tribulation. These are those who have been martyred. They have been beheaded for the word of God and for their testimony of Jesus Christ. And the scripture says there is a multitude of them that cannot be numbered. They're literally filling heaven up as John is observing something that will take place in the future. These saints enter into those pearly gates. We don't know how many people will die, but we know the third part of the men will die. And can you imagine the devastation of that? You've had one fourth in the first six seals. You have had now not just one fourth, but one third. So half of the population that was that was left here on earth after the rapture of the church, they're dead. Including those who have been killed because of their testimony of Jesus Christ. I read someone who said, can you imagine what they'll do with all the bodies? It'll be devastation, despair, fear. And I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and his name that sat on him was Death, and hell followed with him, and power was given to him over the fourth part of the earth, to kill with sword and with hunger and with death and with the beasts of the earth. Revelation chapter 6 and verse number 8. So you have the release of more demons. You have the return of death as one third of those that are remaining on earth are going to die. And then you have the revelation of doom. You could say the revelation of demons. Some have said the revelation of an army. I want us to look at this in Revelation 9:16. And the number of the army of the horsemen were 200,000, that's 200 million. And I heard a number of them. And thus I saw the horses in the vision. Can you imagine? This was more people that was on the face of the earth whenever John saw this vision on the Isle of Patmos. All of the population during the days of John would not have numbered this. And he says, and thus I saw the horses in the vision, and them that sat on them, having breastplates of fire and of jacinth and of brimstone. The breastplates are the color of red, yellow, black, slash blue. And the heads of the horses were as the heads of lions. And out of their mouths issued fire and smoke and brimstone. This is a symbolic description of the devastation of an army that will bring forth hell on earth. There are many great Bible teachers that believe this will be a literal army that will come from the east. And they will be an army, and they believe that he is trying to describe current military weapons that John would have never been able to dream of. That very well could be true. There are other tremendous theologians, just as conservative, Bible-believing teachers that believe this is a description of a demonic horde that will be released by these four. I don't really have a position on it. I just believe that it's symbolic, and I believe it's devastating. Whether it's a literal army, whether it's a demonic army, whether it is a disease and something is being described like that, and I'll tell you why I even mentioned that here in just a minute. We just know that these four demonic beings are going to be released. They are extremely powerful, and they're going to kill a third of the earth. Notice how he tries to describe them. By these three was the third part of men killed by the fire and by the smoke and by the brimstone which issued out of their mouth. For their power is in their mouth and in their tails. For their tails were like unto serpents and had heads, and with them they do hurt. Again, this is the Lord giving a symbolic description. He's using the term like or as. He says it's the power of a demon-inspired army. Horses, lions, serpent. Horses are brave. They'll go into battle. Lions are strong. They're fierce. They're ferocious. They're killers. Serpents are subtle. They're poisonous. They're deadly. He's describing a brave, strong, subtle, poisonous, devastating army, either literally or demonically. And notice what he says, and the rest of the men which were not killed by these, what? Plagues, yet repented not of the works of their hands. You could call an army a plague, whether it's a literal army or a demonic army, or you could be describing something that an angel has ushered out upon the earth. But the bottom line and what we need to get at is the judgment that God is going to pour out upon the earth is going to be extremely painful. It is going to be extremely fearful. It is going to be unprecedentedly devastating. And let's quote the words of Jesus Christ to the disciples. He said, there's going to be what is called the abomination of desolation. This is where the Antichrist will set up his image in the Holy of Holies, in a temple that will be built for the Jews to worship. And whenever that happens, he said, I want you to know that there's going to be tribulation on the earth that the world has never known. He said, great tribulation. He said to those Jewish people listening, he said, if you're out in the fields, whatever you don't do, don't come back. He said, I hope that this does not take place in winter. Jesus was limited in his knowledge on earth willfully. Now I believe he knows the very day, the very hour, the very month when all of this will take place, now that he's restored back into heaven with fellowship with the Father. But while he was on earth, he said, I pray that this does not happen during the winter. And he said, oh, for those that are pregnant, those that are weak. It's going to be a time of great tribulation. And oh, the description. Let's read the description again of this army. By these was the third part of men killed by the fire and by the smoke and by the brimstone. You say, what is this? Whenever you study descriptions of hell given by Jesus Christ in the Gospels, he describes that place as fire and smoke and brimstone. And listen, literally hell is going to be belching out upon the earth. And the rest of the men which were not killed by these plagues, note this, they repented not of the works of their hands. I think this is one of the most amazing things as you'll study through the rest of the judgments. The religion of the defiant. Now there has been, as I've already mentioned, a worldwide revival. In judgment, God has remembered mercy. And God does not have any gratification. He is not pleased with the death of the wicked, but rather that they would repent and receive mercy. But the religion of the defiant, it says that they should not worship, they would not repent, that they should not worship devils and idols of gold and silver and brass and stone and of wood which neither can see nor hear nor walk. First of all, their religion is described, how they worship. They worship idols. Literally says they worship demons. Whenever you study 1 Corinthians chapter number 10, you'll find that the Apostle Paul teaches that behind idolatry is our demons. There's demonic activity affiliated with idolatry. And in Daniel 11:36, it gives us an idea of the idol that they will worship. And the king, that is the Antichrist, shall do as he wills. He shall exalt himself and magnify himself above every god. And Paul writes, and let me finish this in Daniel, and shall speak astonishing things against the God of gods. He shall prosper till the indignation be accomplished, for what is decreed shall be done. In other words, God's decreed this, it's going to happen. What does the Antichrist do? Well, he exalts himself above all the gods. He speaks abominable things against Jesus Christ, God the Father, and God the Holy Spirit. And Paul writes in 2 Thessalonians and describes this event, the abomination of desolation, and he says, who opposes and exalts himself, this is the Antichrist, above all that is called God or that is worshiped, so that he as God sits in the temple of God showing himself that he is God. He exalts himself above every idol, above every religion, above every religious leader, and he declares that he is God and sits in the temple demanding that people come and worship him. The psalmist put it like this: for all the gods of the nations are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. And may I tell you that the Antichrist will be an idol to some people, and they will worship and follow him and take the mark of the beast. Revelation 9:21, he says, neither repented they of their murders, nor of their sorceries, nor of their fornication. Now listen to this: nor of their thefts. So you see the religion of the defiant. Notice the morality that is described. This is how they lived. There were murders. Whenever you talk about murders, this is where all value is gone from human life. People are surrounded by decaying corpses and think nothing of adding to their number. Someone said it is the law of the jungle as people mimic the demon bloodlust. The Bible says that Satan is a murderer. And may I tell you, as the demons of hell are poured out upon this earth and Satan and his demons are kicked out of the heavens, as the scriptures describe, they are going to unleash their activity on this earth. There's immorality. What about immorality? This is the unrepentant immoral. The word is porneia. It is where we get the word pornography from. It refers to every single type of sexual behavior that is not approved by God. And the only sexual behavior that is approved by God is intimacy between one man and one woman as they come together in holy matrimony. A marriage that began in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve that God himself oversaw. And so anything that is sleeping with someone before you're married, that is adultery, sleeping with someone outside of your marriage. That is homosexuality. That is bestiality. That is pedophilia. That is anything that you can imagine. And those sexual sins are all dealt with in both the Old and in the New Testament as you begin to study. And this is going to be rampant all over the earth. There'll be murders. There'll be immorality. You think that this is an age of immorality? It will be nothing like it will be during the tribulation. Mankind will cling to sexual addiction as he abandons himself to the lust of the flesh. Stealing, thefts. People will be unwilling to give up their thieving. John mentions this. The word is used as stealing. Literally, it will become a way of life. Honesty will be non-existent as people attempt and compete and fight for food and clothing and water and shelter and even medical expenses. A grim picture of what is coming. Sorceries. What is sorceries? Well, it's the word pharmakeia, which gives us our English word for pharmacy. It is a word for drugs. Literally, you could say druggings. This word has an elastic use and can be used for incantations, charms, seances, witchcrafts, contacting mediums, spells, all kinds of different things. But it also can be used of rampant drug use. So people are going to be involved in the occult. People are going to be talking to these demons. It's interesting. I had a telephone call not long ago from someone. And they told me that they were talking to an angel. They were having communications with an angel, speaking, and that angel speaking to them. You say, Brother Mark, do you believe that? I really don't. I believe that the Lord speaks to us through his word. And I believe the days of him communicating in other ways, like he did in the Old Testament, he has begun to close those days off. But during that day, listen, occultism will be rampant. Drug use will be rampant. It'll be a day where men will be filled with fear and with anxiety, but yet their hearts will be so hardened against God and against his Christ. The Bible says the Spirit of God will not always strive with man. And I believe you see that put on display in this portion of Scripture, maybe more than any portion of Scripture in the entire Old or New Testament. They will not repent, and the Spirit of God will no longer strive with them. He will abandon them to their own detriment and damnation and desire. They will refuse Christ, and Christ will pour out his wrath, the wrath of the Lamb, during this time of great tribulation. A time of great tribulation that the world has never known and will never, ever, ever know again, Jesus said in Matthew 24. And as we look at those first two woes, the fifth and the sixth trumpet judgment, I pray that we never know anything like that before then, and I pray that we never know anything like it after then. And I pray that if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, that you'll call upon the name of Jesus Christ and be saved, and therefore you'll escape the wrath to come. We so pray that for you. Call upon Jesus Christ. Just simply say, I believe that Jesus died for my sin, that he was buried and rose again the third day. And oh, if you do that out of a truly repentant heart, turning to God and turning from your sin, turning from your plans of how you can get to heaven, and to the only plan that has been given, Jesus Christ, the eternal God, dying on a cross for you, the Scripture says you'll be saved. God bless you, and thank you so much for being with us.